Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint right here on Urban TV. My name is Nicholas Wasajja. Now, last week on Thursday, President Yoweri Museveni delivered the State of the Nation address and he sounded very optimistic about Uganda recovering its economy post-COVID-19. He categorized Uganda's economy in two ways. He said we have the real economy and we also have the vulnerable economy. And in the real economy, he said it is still leaping on, while the vulnerable economy has suffered setbacks, but it will also get back because it is supported by the real economy. In the real economy, he talked about sectors like agriculture, the services sectors like health and education, security. The president also delivered the long-awaited interventions in terms of recovering the economy. And largely, he highlighted 14 major interventions, but key among them were tax waivers, where he indicated that companies, small, medium enterprises, companies in the tourism sector, the manufacturing industry, will be getting tax waivers, or some taxes, like for example, pay as you earn, corporation tax, will be deferred until further notice, until the economy gets back to its feet. To discuss this and more is the country senior partner, PricewaterhouseCoopers, Mr. Francis Kamlegea. Francis, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
What are your impressions about last week's State of the Nation address?
Right, like you said, it was very long awaited. For quite some time we've heard that there's an economic stimulus yet to be unveiled by government. So we had it. When you consider what was in that stimulus, it gives you a good perspective and reflection of the possibilities as far as our country and economy is concerned. Elsewhere, we've seen governments giving tax exemptions, giving cash injections to enterprises, and even in some cases giving handouts to citizens to enable them to be able to meet their basic needs as well as stimulate demand in the economy. In our case, we didn't see any of that. We also know that the businesses were demanding or requesting certain measures like tax exemptions, government paying their utility bills, and in some cases even intervention between landlords and tenants, and also low interest rates. Again, we didn't see that. So what we saw is measures that are mainly aimed at easing the cash flow of business. And personally, I do welcome that. The commitment to pay arrears, both in terms of domestic arrears, people who are owed money by government, I understand that is in excess of about 3 trillion shillings, and also VAT refunds, which also hold up cash flow, that has to be very well, a good measure and welcomed. Earlier on at the beginning of the lockdown, Revenue Authority intervened by giving people more time to pay tax and file their returns on time. But again, the challenge with that was that if you pay later, you end up having to pay interest and penalties, which did not sound like an intervention of any kind. In the State of the Nation address, the president clearly indicated that small and medium enterprises will be given more time to pay their taxes, up to about 6 months, up to September, and there will be no interest and penalties. That is a very good measure. All the measures were really aimed at easing cash flow, because businesses are hurting right now because they've been under lockdown, they haven't been trading, and they have not been earning revenue. And as long as measures aimed at easing cash flow are embraced and businesses do the right thing, I strongly believe that the economy will recover and recover quickly.
Francis, yes, they are good interventions, but one then on the other hand would like to understand How then will government cope with domestic revenue mobilization? Because you understand June is the beginning of the new financial year. When you say about 6 months, that means almost more than a quarter of the first quarter. Doesn't this mean that there is not going to be generation of revenue? And then what happens then to government delivery of services?
Okay, I think government has not waived tax payment.
Yes.
Government is giving businesses more time to pay tax. And a financial year is 12 months. So I would like to think that in the process of budgeting for the period 1st of July 2020 to 30th of June 2021, government is going to phase its cash flow in such a way that it is in sync with the tax revenue collections. So we already know that government is going to have to borrow to the tune of nearly 50% of the budget for next financial year. So when that money comes in, possibly it will be used to front load the expenditure in the first 3 or 6 months as government waits for taxes to be paid later on. So the budget of 45.5 trillion is going to be funded 72.5% by domestic revenue from domestic sources, of which about 21.7 is tax revenue. 21.7 trillion shillings, in my view, is money that can be collected from this economy, given the size of the economy. As long as people who should be paying tax are paying tax, as long as the whole culture of voluntary compliance is embraced, there's a lot of tax leakage, some of it by evasion, some of it by just people not knowing how much tax they should be paying, and some of it by just under declaration, whether it is sales or importation. So I'm optimistic. I mean, this year alone, hard as it has been, revenue collections are going to grow by close to a trillion shillings. Having said that, the revenue collection will be below the target that government set itself, but in absolute terms, there will be growth.
Francis, you talked of linkages in revenue collections, and this has been a huge challenge to government to fix before, prior to COVID-19. Are you saying post-COVID-19, or as we leap forward, government will, within this short time and with the challenges that the country is facing, government will be able to fix these linkages so that it can, however little it is, it can be able to mobilize those resources?
I think government will be able to do that. You see, when you talk about government, you then have to talk about businesses. So for the 2 months that we've been under lockdown, business people have been saying to government, lift the lockdown so that we can go to work. So businesses in Uganda are very resilient. Their business people are very entrepreneurial, that the moment you open the space, they would go back and start from where they
come back from that very short break. You're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja. Today we are discussing how businesses can get back on their feet in these COVID times. And to discuss this with me is the senior partner, PricewaterhouseCoopers, Mr. Francis Kamlige. Francis, if I were a business person, in these times, I wouldn't consider going for a commercial loan to sustain my business. And yet, these are times when most people will be considering financing. Are there other alternatives that SMEs can exploit to maintain their businesses?
Nicholas, actually, this is the time actually to speak to your bank. Yes, you may already have a loan with a bank, and yes, you may be having challenges with servicing that loan, but the whole concept of loan restructuring is actually to go back to your bank and tell them that whereas before the lockdown I was able to pay back, you know, 1 million, 2 million shillings a month, I've not been trading for 3 months, and for that matter I'm having a challenge, so I need more time to pay back the loan. In addition to that, not only do I need more time, but actually I need more money so that I can kickstart my business. We need to understand that it is in the bank's interest for businesses to survive. If you lend somebody money and that person is struggling, it is in your interest to support that person to recover from this temporary setback that they have been through as a result of lockdown, and that may require you giving them more money. And you don't just give them more money, but also try and provide them more support, because the challenge with SMEs is that they get money from the bank based on business plans and projections that they've prepared. But when they receive the cash, they go and do totally different things that are totally unrelated to the reason for which they went and seek the money. And banks will tell you that the major reasons why businesses default on money is not because businesses went bad. It's simply because somebody came to you and they said they're going to start a factory processing coffee, and they showed you the cash flows. You know the demand for coffee. You know the price it takes to set up a factory. You gave them money. And when you gave them money, they went and started building a shopping mall. And building a shopping mall takes, you know, 2-3 years. And it will take you nearly 10 years to get that money back. And, you know, redeploying money that was meant for other things is the major cause of financial distress for SMEs. So my advice to SMEs, one, you need to formalize. And Nicholas, when I say formalize, and I'm not saying anything really fancy, as in set up a corporation and do all sorts of fancy things that we big businesses do. Simply have a set of records that show your income and expenditure. If you have been under lockdown and your shop in any one of the arcades has stock, how much stock do you have? What is its value? Is there a record that shows how much stock is in that building? And then if you've not been selling for 3 months and you now open, should you try and sell that stock at a lower price so that you offload it, get money and get back into the cycle of trading? Or are you going to try and sell at the other high prices that you try to sell at, yet the economy is very depressed in terms of consumer demand? So the issue of not having records, the issue of people having all the prices in their heads but they don't have a database of prices, the issue of people paying taxes arbitrarily yet they don't have a basis on which the assessments are being issued. There are so many SMEs, especially importers, who pay more tax than they should be paying by the law, simply because, you know, they don't have records and there's no proper basis of assessing them. So my advice, speak to your bank, speak to your suppliers, try as much as possible to have a cordial relationship with your landlord, because he or she needs you as well. Make sure that laying off people is the last resort, because you cannot do it on your own.
But you talk about some of the challenges that commercial banks raise when they are dealing with business people. What does this say about our work ethic as a country, and how can work ethics ensure labor productivity if everyone told that line?
So when research comes and says Ugandans are the most entrepreneurial people in the world, I believe it, because even people we employ here, they have something on the side, yeah? And people are very entrepreneurial, people are very creative, and they are always looking to do something to earn money on the side, and that is a good thing. Secondly, work ethic. Yes, we've had ourselves being compared to other people in terms of work ethic. To some extent, those are issues to do with maybe the culture, depending on what your tribe is and the way you are brought up, and how much, you know, you've been used to in terms of pushing yourself beyond the bare minimum. But the truth is, we are a very entrepreneurial country. We do not have social security in this country, so everybody knows that if I don't work, I won't eat. My concern is, at times we don't push ourselves to as much as we should. At times we come across with a very low threshold of comfort, and somebody has a 3-bedroom house, they have a 4-wheel drive car, and they're earning 8 million shillings, and they think they've arrived. And they just start living within those means. And in fact, every more money they earn, they change their lifestyle to spend the money. And that's why you found all this clamor about even people in formal employment struggling to meet their needs just after 2 months lockdown. So we are not as resilient as we should be. The other problem is, much as we're entrepreneurial, we are not as innovative and creative. So when you see somebody setting up a new takeaway chicken and chips, you also do the same. When you see somebody starting a kindergarten, then you also convert your garage into a kindergarten. When you see your neighbor starting a salon, you also start a salon. You've not done any research. You don't know even where your customers are going to come from. You do not even know what it takes to run that business. So there are so many businesses that start up because of copycats, and very few of those survive.
Where is the difference between being entrepreneurial and being innovative and creative?
Well, entrepreneurial is knowing that I need to do something to earn a living, and I'm not just going to go and look for a job because nobody owes me anything. And looking into the market and finding a need and then starting business. But after starting business, you then need to be a bit more agile. You need to be more innovative. I've given you the example of hair salon. If there are people who run salons and honestly they're sitting home and the president has told them that your business is so difficult to social distance, you're going to be the last people to be opened up. And you're sitting waiting to be opened up. Yet the lady who used to do her hair twice a week, the gentleman who used to cut hair once a week still needs that service. You need to be creative and reach out to that customer and make sure that they know you are available and you can do the service. And I'm very comfortable my hairdresser coming to my house because I'm just interacting with him. We'll wash the hands, we'll sanitize, we'll wear the mask, we'll social distance, and he'll do the job and we'll get paid his 15,000. But if you just sit back, so that is the point. It's very easy to start the business because somebody has started business, but the creativity and innovation and agility and trying to upscale and do something beyond where you started is where we are.
Going back to financing SMEs, could equity financing be